Welcome to the 91 Untold Change Project. I'm Neil Almond, your host for today's podcast. In the studio, we have James Smith. Now, the reason for inviting James to be part of the Change Project is he's one of the pioneers of the social enterprise movement in the UK. My friendship with him goes back probably to 1999 or something like that, when I was a student at the School for Social Entrepreneurs and he was leading the school. He set up the school originally with Michael Young, Lord Young of Dartington, who's perhaps best known for founding Open University, Consumers Association, along with probably 100 other social organizations. And I think between James's own experience of social enterprise and working with hundreds of organizations, some of which have done incredibly well, some of which not so well, and I think there's something in that space, and his experience of working alongside such an incredible serial social entrepreneur as Michael Young, I really hope there's something we can add to the Change Project through this conversation. These days, James is a social and environmental leadership consultant with a real passion for strategy, innovation, leadership. So again, I'm sure some of that will come into the podcast as well. I hope you enjoy it. I hope it adds value. I'll see you after the intro. Welcome to the 91 Untold Change Project.
The whole universe is in a state of entropy.
If you can unlock that higher motivation, they'll be with you.
How do you create an environment where people can find meaning at work?
That can create the needed culture change.
How does radical change happen?
You know it's a good business.
In terms of our evolution, we were not required to have a conscious understanding of complex systems.
What creates great innovation in the social arena?
It starts with you taking action.
Have some real sense of control over our lives.
Welcome. Thank you for being here.
You're welcome. Thank you, Neil.
Okay, so maybe to begin with, to sort of ease ourselves in, can you give me an idea? What is it you do on a day-to-day basis? What are you doing that... I know you changed the world because I've known you long enough to know that, but what is it you actually do?
Most of what I do encompasses talking with people about what they're trying to do and trying to match up different people's viewpoints, helping people to collaborate, helping people to think together about how they can move, progress with what it is that they're achieving. So let me give you an example on the current project that I'm working on is to do the planning for the development of a Caribbean Energy Knowledge Hub, working with the CARICOM Secretariat. For those of you who don't know, CARICOM is something like the EU for Caribbean states. It's not as integrated as the EU and doesn't have quite the same lawmaking powers, but it's an association of countries. And they have between them decided to on a sustainable energy roadmap and strategy, but they're having difficulty actually pursuing this as a regional strategy and achieving the targets that they've set themselves. They need access to the best information and knowledge they can have in order to help them in this transition.
Lovely. And that sort of leads on to, you know, one of your specialisms is innovation. Obviously, you've been around social entrepreneurs for quite a while now and have had quite
Thanks.
A few. Yeah. Well, I was thinking back to, it's like, as I was sort of saying, 1999 is when, it's like, makes me sound old. Kind of, let's pretend we've only known each other for a couple of years and been working at this for a couple of years. But you've observed a lot of projects. You've seen a lot of people, some of which have been hugely innovative, some of which perhaps haven't. What's the difference? What creates great innovation in the social arena?
Well, I've always believed in the power of individuals. This is why we set up the School for Social Entrepreneurs, because there was that sense that individuals can make a difference, because they can as it were, infect other people with a creative mindset, with an innovative mindset within an organization, and that can create the needed culture change. What I don't think there are any hard and fast rules about what makes for good innovation or what causes innovation to fail. I've seen a lot of good ideas fail for many, many reasons. And I've seen fairly bad ideas succeed for many, many reasons as well. And I think that the possibly the difference that I would say is most important is playing the politics, the small p politics, correctly is the biggest difference. Actually, that unless there are people associated with a project who understand how to play the game right, how to get support from sufficiently powerful people and sufficient gatekeepers to allow a project to happen, is actually probably the most important thing. It doesn't necessarily answer the question about where does the innovation come from, but I think that's probably the biggest difference between the projects that go somewhere and those that don't. And therefore, you have this difficulty that bad ideas, where you have people there who do know how to play the politics right, often succeed in that they happen.
Yes.
Doesn't necessarily mean they achieve the objectives that they wanted or that they achieve any beneficial social change.
I think that's really, really interesting, and I absolutely agree with you. I've seen some tremendous projects fail, as you say, and others that really, really shouldn't have got there. As you think about innovation, though, if someone's in an organisation right now and it's stale, there's nothing happening. I had this situation a couple of weeks ago where the person was talking to me, how do I think about something new? I know we need something new, but how do I actually think about that? Have you noticed in the people you've worked with any particular characteristics that have made successful innovation work more effectively, or creativity, or anything like that?
I think that if we go back to Michael Young and start there, the thing that Michael had right up until the end was that he always questioned everything. He never assumed that because something's the way it is, that that's the way it always should be or has to be. I think we have a trope in our society of saying, well, that's the way it's always been, and it'll never change.
Yeah.
It'll never change. People are very good at predicting things will never change. Something I talk about with my father-in-law quite a lot.
Does he listen to podcasts?
I don't think so.
Okay, fine.
But I'll still be careful about what I say. But for instance, when I tried to talk with him about inequality and the possibilities for a world that's organised in a different way, where you have a far more equal society, he says there's always been rich people and there always will be.
Yeah.
Well, how does he know? Yeah. he knows because he has told himself that.
Yes.
Whereas someone like Michael never told himself, this is the way it is, this is the way it always will be. And I think that there are probably people in most organisations who think like that, but they're not necessarily in positions of power. So if you're if you are in a position of power in an organisation and you know things need to change, but you don't know what should change, well, then ask people.
Yeah.
Because you're likely to find someone who's got some ideas. And having those ideas and responding positively to those ideas can start the process whereby you encourage other people to have ideas, whereby you support ideas and are therefore able to create the conditions for change.
I really like that. That, again, it's back to that questioning, isn't it? And the quality of that questioning, I think that is an important thing for people to get better and better at doing, is looking at their questions and noticing the responses that they're getting. You mentioned Michael Young there, Lord Young of Dartington, and obviously he was a serial social entrepreneur, you probably could list his accomplishments way better than I could, but was it the Consumers Association, School for Social Entrepreneurs alongside yourself, Open University, I think he had a very big hand in. Mm-hmm. Incredible thinker and managed to bring those, the fact that many, many years on, most of them are still a big part of our society says something about the way in which they were created. Were there any other lessons you learnt from him that you think have held you in good stead as you've gone through your career?
Money is important because it buys time. So I think that one of the things that I noticed was Michael would always treat where the money was coming from seriously, never to the detriment of what it was you were trying to achieve, but in order to buy people's time to work on something, a sense that if you work on something over a continued period that no one else is working on, that's different. You're already creating change by the fact simply that someone is working on this, and the longer you can keep going, the more you're likely to achieve. And if you keep the right attitude in the organization, then you can continue to question what it is that you're doing until you find something that works.
Okay.
So I think that's one lesson. I'm just trying to think back, because I remember when we had the memorial conference for Michael for the School for Social Entrepreneurs, I did write a list of my... what were my lessons I learned from Michael?
There was certainly one of my memories of him, which isn't really a lesson, but just giving you time to think, was very much that top floor room at the SSE, him being up there in the kitchen eating his tomato soup at lunchtime, and kind of how humble he was, that me as a student going in there and being able to talk to him at that point, that humility seemed to come across very much for me. You obviously knew him much, much better. You might go, no way!
I think that one of the key lessons that I learned from him is that entrepreneurs, the entrepreneurial approach, requires moving between extremes at the appropriate frequency.
Okay.
So, for instance, needing to be both flexible and rigid, and that you obviously can't do both at exactly the same time, but so working out the moments when you need to be hard and say, no, we're doing it, this is what we're doing,
right?
And then working out the other moments when you say, well, okay, I'm open to ideas about how this is working.
I
think that there's a, I don't know how well I'm explaining that, but one of the things that he talked about was points of crystallization on a journey towards social entrepreneurship. And as though you start up your working on your issue, you open things up, you get lots of things moving on different tracks, and then you have points at which you regroup and you say, okay, here's my new conception of what this is. And then you start again from that new point, and the whole process repeats and repeats and repeats, to make sure that you're on track to capture the best of the ideas and the best of the things that are happening, but also to ensure that you don't constantly waste effort because you're getting diverted in a million and one different directions, because you will.
Yeah.
You have to, he always talked about working with the grain of social change. And therefore, you have to respond to the opportunities that arise. You have to respond to other people and other organizations and the way that they're currently working and the opportunities that arise in collaborating with them. But if you only ever do that, you get dragged down on other people's agendas and you don't end up achieving the things that you set out to achieve in the first place. So that's why you need these moments of crystallization and culling the ideas that aren't achieving what you want them to achieve, culling the actions that aren't achieving what you want them to achieve.
Very interesting, and that culling piece as well. It's like one of the things I often attribute to you in a nice way. I remember back in the when I was doing stuff around the School for Social Entrepreneurs and working with you around there, I can vividly remember a conversation about how charities often get to a point way beyond their social purpose, and they exist only for the staff that exists within them. And it was a conversation that was quite poignant for me, and was a major catalyst for after the plane crash when we got to the point of making decisions about Kick-Ass as a charity, as an organisation. We looked around for a new leader to take it on, and there was no shortage of people who were willing to step into the CEO shoes, but we couldn't find anyone who would take it, who had a vision for where to take it beyond my thinking. And really, that's what we were looking for, was not someone who we'll continue to do exactly what you're doing. We wanted someone who was going to go, let's take it beyond this, let's take that foundation and move it further. And one of the decision we took at the end, without that person, it was better to close it down and create a space in the market for the next innovative organization to come through, rather than filling that space. I'm sure somebody could have got a lot of money for it and continued for it to thrive, but I think it wouldn't have had the impact that Kick-Ass had in its heyday, be my guess.
There is a cycle that organizations go through, and there are points at which they have outlived their usefulness. They can be revived. It does take it that, as you say, that mindset to think, right, well, in this new world, what is it that's now needed? I've worked for a long time with the Renewable Energy and Energy Efficiency Partnership, REAP, which was set up in 2002, came out of the Johannesburg Earth Summit. And that, at the time, in 2002, renewable energy wasn't a big thing. And a lot of the initial effort was simply trying to promote the idea of renewable energy to governments around the world and to others. But then after, I think it must have been around 2011, so after sort of 9 years or something, the original Director General left, and there was an opening for the Director General, and when he came in, he realized we need some new thinking. The world is not the same. Renewable energy in China was one of the big priority countries initially in 2002 and during that first decade of REAP's life, but beyond that point they had already got the idea that renewable energy was the way forward. Yes, there are issues about building coal plants as well rapidly during that time, but there was always the intention that was as a fill-in gap until they could develop the renewable energy to a sufficient extent that that they wouldn't need that reliance on fossil fuels anymore. But by the time 10 years later, when the new director general took over, well, China has enormous renewable energy industries, huge generation of wind and solar power. And there's no need to try and persuade them that they should be doing renewable energy anymore. You know, that's simply not an issue.
Yes.
And therefore, there are things that REAP had to think very differently about. Well, what's our role? Is there a role for us within this situation? And if so, what is it? And it's ended up as a very different organisation, focusing on a totally different kind of niche sector within a field that is now too big for an organisation of REAP size to say, we're going to encompass all of this. There's now an organisation called IRENA. I don't know how many times REAP size it is in terms of staff members and budget, which is the International Renewable Energy Organisation. But that can take on that general sort of diplomacy role, working with countries, and REAP now focuses on private sector organisations and working with those organisations to accelerate markets.
That's interesting. And one of the questions that I often talk to clients about is, are you doing now what you need to do in order to be relevant in in a few years' time? And I'm kind of hearing that in what you're saying there.
Well, I think that, yes, absolutely. And there's nothing new in this thinking. You know, Charles Handy has been talking about having the next curve ready for when this one is on the decline for decades now. So there's nothing new in this. But I think certainly the sense of foresight and trying to work out what will be needed, not now, but not just what is needed now, but what will be needed in 5 years, what will be needed in 10 years is very important.
Absolutely. He also spoke about cathedral builders, of course.
He did.
What's your view on that? How do we get people, you know, the idea of cathedral builders to my mind was this from ancient times where the architect would never expect to see a cathedral actually completed. It just was in his head, and then it went out into the world and became this magnificent building. To my mind, we need a few more cathedral builders in the world, and that was his point 15, 20 years ago. Any views about how we can get more cathedral builders, or indeed, do we need them, or is there something else now in today's world that we need?
I think we are getting more. Without wanting to harp on about our age again, I think that there are a lot of young people growing up who, and maybe this is something to do with this being the early years of the century, but there are people growing up now who realise that the world has to change, yeah. that the 21st century is going to be a time of an enormous transition. Climate change makes this an imperative. And I think that there are people who see that as way bigger than their own lifetimes or what they're able to achieve themselves. There's something that I'm not involved in any way other than giving them a small donation every now and then is our Children's Trust in the US, who are bringing legislation against the US government for denying them their constitutional rights by continuing to burn fossil fuels, even though they've known for decades that this is bad for the planet. These group of young people have said that how can we have our right, exercise our right to the pursuit of life, liberty and happiness in a country, in a world where the climate is restraining our choices? And that case is going to come to court at some point in the near future.
Fantastic. Yeah, I agree with you there in terms of hope, and Mason's sitting over there behind the cameras and everything, and it's wonderful having his energy is so important to me within these conversations, again, to bring that hope, that kind of millennial hope to bear on some of the old wizened cynicism that's developed over the years. You said something very interesting before with regards to your father-in-law, not wanting to go too deep into that, but you talked about this possibility of a more equal society, and you know that in your map it sounded like that was actually possible. There was something that could happen in that space, perhaps in his history and the way that he thought about it didn't make that so possible. What's your thought? Is there a formula? Have you got any ideas? How could we have a more equal society?
Universal basic income obviously is garnering a lot of attention, and I think that that's one idea that can be explored. I think there are many, many ideas. I think that the current obsession of Western capitalist societies with taxation being a bad thing has to end. This is ridiculous. You can't have a good services for most people in a world where the rich people won't pay taxes. That simply has to, we have to change that as an acceptable moral position. And I think that that's entirely possible to do. I think people have very short memories. And I am old enough to remember a time before our current rapacious capitalism took over the world. when there were a lot of competing attitudes about the way the world should work that were given just as much attention in the media. And I think that once again, this is hopefully another thing that the younger generations will get the opportunity to work through in their lives, to question the what the hegemony of a certain political mindset, which has been all of my adult life in the UK. But it's not the way that things work in other parts of the world. It's not the way that things work in some of the Scandinavian countries where they have a far higher tax regime. It's not the way that things happen in countries in Africa and Asia where people have a far more collective idea about the way that they live their lives. So I don't think that anything lasts forever. And I think that there's lots of possibilities of how things could change.
And do you have any views about how we move from where we are now to that more equal world? I mean, as you say, that's one possible way forward, but I am interested about how that transition come out and how that sort of change actually takes place in your head. And how it comes out of your head and actually comes into the world, because I would approve
in the world. I like to think of things. I think that a good way of understanding social change is to think about different movements that we are all of us a part of, whether knowingly or not, a part of different movements in society. And I think that it is those movements which no one directly controls, which are the result of millions and millions of individual decisions and actions, but which people can influence. It's the result of those movements that creates serious changes in society. If you think about the development of the internet, this is a movement that had its pioneers and its trailblazers, and then a series of sort of people who were early on the uptake before this became a mass thing in our lives. And during that entire development, no one person decided this is how this is going to develop. And even now, when we're all starting to get worried about the big four large companies controlling too much of it, they don't control the way that digitalization works in everyone's lives. They're trying to put their arms around bits of it and say, this is ours, and within this area, we are going to control the way that people work. And of course, that's worrying, but that's happening within a much larger social movement, which has swept the entire globe within 20 years. One thing I am is very optimistic that things can change very, very quickly.
Yes.
And I was... I heard a webinar where someone was talking about the development of the fossil fuel industry, and they showed two pictures. One picture was Times Square in 1901, and what they said is, spot the car.
Right.
And somewhere in there amongst horse-drawn carriages and people walking was one motor car. And then they showed a picture of 1911 and they said, spot the horse-drawn carriage. And there was one. And that's how quick things change. And that's how quickly things will change with renewable energy, for instance, when the price of batteries gets sufficiently low. Things will suddenly go.
Yes.
The fossil fuel industries will die, not because anyone has killed them, but because there's something better that's just as cheap or cheaper. And so I think that the same thing can happen in terms of people's attitudes, the majority of people's attitudes to inequality in society. The same thing happened, once again, that Michael Young was highly involved in after the Second World War. Again, for those who don't know, anyone listening to this, Michael Young wrote Let Us Face the Future, the Labour Manifesto, for the 1945 general election, and it was following that general election that the modern welfare state was set up. This was completely revolutionary. It was decades in the making to get to the point when that could happen. But when it happened, there was a sufficient impetus because of the World War and everything that people have been through to make that happen, and it happened. And I think the same thing will happen, hopefully, at some point around climate change, that people will realise that actually the biggest problem that we have that's creating climate change isn't the fossil fuel industry, it's the rapacious capitalism that drives that fossil fuel industry to fight the changes that it knows full well need to happen.
I like that. You spoke about organisations having a natural cycle as well, and it just in my head as you were talking about that, I was thinking about, you know, obviously you have come from the social enterprise movement, you advise a lot of social organisations and charities, and you know, have understand the business community as well. Do you think there's, you know, we're still going to have businesses, charities, social enterprises in 10 years' time? Do you think there's going to be changes in the way those organizations exist, or how do you think the future looks around that sort of stuff?
I think the future looks diverse. I think the interesting thing about these different vehicles, the different models of organization that can exist, is that they're mix and match. So the best social entrepreneurs and the best social enterprises, to my mind, always use these different organizational models anyway as tools, and you would get groups with different models within that, where a profit-making business was supporting a social or community purpose business, or a variety of different things. This is definitely one of the things that I learned from Michael is that the particular type of organization doesn't dictate the way you work. Just because something is set up as a company limited by shares doesn't mean it has to only focus on profit making.
Absolutely. And do you think there'll be, do you think there's going to be a movement towards that? You talked about capitalism, and sometimes it feels like we're actually getting further away from that social purpose to a commercial organisations. Other times it feels like we're almost getting a blend, and there's this possibility, particularly as you start to look at organisations that are considering their impact on the teams working within them and the impact they have on their customers, and you know, there's some really exciting stuff potentially happening there as well. What are your thoughts about how, I don't, there's a question in there somewhere, about how, do you think that there is going to be more social imperative within organizations, or do you think we're going to, it's almost going to be a bubble that bursts and something new has to come in?
I think there will be a growing number of nominally for-profit businesses that choose to seriously follow social imperatives. I think that's inevitable. Whether they will become the majority, or whether they will become the majority in terms of their size and their sort of collective power, I don't know. There will always be organizations. Well, there will always. I said they should never say that, right? I think within my lifetime, there will be organizations that exist just to make their owners rich.
Yeah.
So sort of optimistic that I think that's going to stop anytime soon. I think it might one day stop entirely, but who knows? But there are with this new generation of kids growing up internet savvy, with access to information about what's going on around the world, I think that it's inevitable that you get different expectations that people place on their workplace. And I think that there are the roots already of serious changes where companies are starting to understand that they're going to attract the best talent if they are not just greenwashing or social washing what they do, but if it's meaningful.
Yes.
That they're not just trying to fob the public off by saying, okay, for every 1,000 we make, we'll give one away and call that our corporate social responsibility, and we won't have to worry about how we make the 1,000 because we're doing this good thing with this one over here. I think that more and more people are going to question that. However, there is a counter movement which is trying to take individual agency out of people's working lives, yeah. And that's artificial intelligence. And I think that there's a whole load of work that needs to be done around that in the coming decades, around how we regulate the use of artificial intelligence, because the danger is that individuals who are employed are de-skilled.
Yes.
Because higher and higher skilled jobs will get given to automated processes which can simply do them way, way, way cheaper.
Yes. And do you think, if someone's listening and they're a leader within an organisation and they want to think more progressively, or they want their organisation to be a bit kinder or whatever, any thoughts about the steps that people can take, or from the observation you've made of businesses, is there a difference that makes a difference that can be tapped into?
Stop thinking that the ethics you apply in your own life are should be any different from the ethics you apply in your business life. I think we've created a distinction between the two, and I think that there are a lot of people who are good people who want to live a good life, who wouldn't dream of hurting the people around them, who throw that ethical mindset out of the window when they get to work, because it's supposed to be impersonal, it's supposed to... So be more human at work.
Which comes perfectly after the conversation about AI as well. Maybe that's the solution there as well. One of the questions that I try and ask everyone, which is almost like the huge killer question, if you like, which is, how does change happen? Do you have any thoughts on that, about what it is that actually creates change and how change happens in the world or in organizations or in personal lives?
Well, again, I would talk about movements and about there being a whole... For serious change to happen, it relies on lots and lots of people taking different decisions, behaving differently, living their lives differently. And I think that this can happen in a whole variety of different ways. It can start from any different point, but there are always catalysts. There are always people kind of cranking the wheel of social change. And I think that one of the things that's important is that people come upon the same idea at the same time. This was one of the things that happened with social entrepreneurship, that in the UK, that at the time that we were setting up the School for Social Entrepreneurs, there were a number of other organisations started to use the term as well.
Yes.
Not that social entrepreneurs were invented at that point in the 1990s. They've obviously always been with us. They've always been part of society. But that there were a number of people started to use the terminology, and that helped to create this impetus for a movement. And that helped to spread the ideas out. And then there were a number of these things that happened, these points of crystallization, as it were, that helped to propel that movement forwards. One of the things I've definitely learned is that you can't control the way that movement develops. I left the UK, as you know, in 2005, and I lived in France for a long time. And coming back to the UK and looking at the social entrepreneurship field in 2015 It looked very different from when I left in 2005. There's a whole load of different people got on board of that movement and took it in different ways. And that's always something that's going to happen. There was something else I wanted to say about that. Ask me the question.
So one of the things that I'm hearing in a lot of the conversation we're having is that change over the next few years is inevitable. There's, you know, it's almost like a constant that we're dealing with. Have you got any thoughts about how people can prepare themselves for that or become more resilient to it or get out ahead of it, if you like?
I don't know that's really possible because it's so difficult to foresee what's going to happen. I think that how can people be more resilient is a better part of that question. How can people be more prepared for change? And I think that that's about, a lot of that is about thinking through what are the potential outcomes. Scenario planning, I think, is very interesting. And I think thinking about what are the potential outcomes of what you do in terms of potential negative outcomes as well as potential positive outcomes from any situation that you're looking at is important. I think that, for instance, in the strategy work I do with organizations, a lot of people tend to plan their strategy based on they want to do some actions because it feels like it's the right thing to do, and then they assume that the outcomes will be what they're hoping for, and then they build another step on that. And then they assume the outcomes of that will be good, and then they build another step on that, and then everything's bright and rosy in five Yes. years' time. And then they wonder why this, the years later, why this strategy wasn't actually of any use to them.
Yes.
Well, I think sort of thinking through what happens if this doesn't work, what are the potential negative outcomes, what are the things that could go wrong as I'm moving forward, and being just as ready for those as you are for the good things that could happen. That's always the way that I try to think about developments in any organization I'm working with. And I think in my life as well, I try to think through what are the potential consequences of taking this decision. I think that being a lot slower to take decisions is generally a good idea in life. Not feeling rushed into having to react on the pace that someone else is imposing on you. And thinking very, very carefully before you take decisions that are likely to have an impact, a serious impact on your life, your work, your relationships, whatever it might be.
Which wonderfully links back to Michael Young's comments about money buys you time as well.
Time is very important. And as you mentioned earlier, thinking about the burn rate of what you're doing, thinking about giving yourself the maximum amount of time to work things through and work things out is generally a good approach when you're trying to do something new that you don't know how to do it.
Fantastic.
Society is again, back to the big, society is made up of relationships between people and between groups of people. And it's in changing those relationships that things really change. And so I suppose that's where you could say something like the internet, social media, etc., is a big social change because it does change the way that people interact for both good and bad.
Yeah.
Social change is never, you know, there's no value attached to it. It's something that happens the entire time. But so I think that if you are trying to change society for the better in some way, then it's in those interactions between people and between groups of people that the improvement comes. That's what affects people in their lives beyond a certain point. I mean, obviously, yeah. you've got your Maslow's hierarchy, whatever, and people have to have food, they have to have shelter, whatever. But beyond that, the quality of people's lives, for most people, is controlled by the interactions that they have with the people around them, with their family, with their neighbours, with their community, with their friends, and with the people who they work with. And so a lot of people's lives can be changed immensely by changing job or by getting a new boss.
Yes.
Who treats them in a more human manner, who's kinder to them and more responsive to their own, to that other person's humanity and to their own desire for agency, their own desire to do something meaningful with their life. That can change everything. And I think that going into meetings with the attitude that you're trying to understand another person and where they're coming from and what it is that they're trying to do is something that I attempt to do in all of my work, to sit down with someone and really understand. And that's part of the privilege, I guess, of being a consultant, is I don't go into projects with a strong agenda of what I'm trying to achieve, other than to make the situation better for as many people as possible. So starting a project around the Caribbean Energy Knowledge Hub, it's a question of who are the people who are trying to do the right thing and how do we make their lives better, easier, and allow them therefore to be more effective. I think that a lot of what I've done in my career has been about this. The School for Social Entrepreneurs is about this. It's not about, I think the world needs to change in this, that, or the other way. Beyond that general, we should support people who are trying to do good things in the world and help them to get better. And I think that I apply that to everything. I'm applying that to the Caribbean Energy Knowledge Hub. There are people within these governments and utilities who are genuinely interested in what's the progressive way forward. And finding and supporting those people and allowing them to pass on their enthusiasm to others within the organisation who perhaps didn't share it, therefore collectively hitting a tipping point about, all right, this is the right way forward. We do need to stop using burning oil. We do need to build more wind farms or more solar parks. I think that that's really what I've tried to do, and that starts with those relationships.
And is there some belief or value that you need to have in order to go in with that open mind you're talking about? Because most people go in with a fixed agenda or their own thoughts in their head. So how do you do that differently? Because I don't think it's quite as simple as you're making it sound.
No, I suppose it's not. For me, it was a very gradual process, I think, of which started probably with failing. Started with the first time I worked on an organisation that failed and went bust. And starting to think more carefully about how I approach things and starting to realise the extent to which you have to understand the other side in order to achieve what you want to achieve. If you impose something through an abuse of power and through fear, it'll hold for a certain time, and it'll hold for a certain time only. And so if you want a more sustainable approach to whatever it might be, then you have to understand the other person and understand that their needs and desires are just as important as your own.
That's quite a profound thing. And is there... I get that's how you got to it, but how do you do it? I know Gandhi allegedly used to go and actually sit in the seats of the people during a negotiation, try and get access to the room beforehand. whether that actually happened or not, I'm not sure. But to almost pretend he was them and therefore get into their head and try and think through what they want in advance. Is yours something like that in terms of process, or just almost getting yourself out of the way and having a curiosity about what they might be saying and actually listening to it? Where are you on that?
I think curiosity, definitely. It came from an understanding of, and again, I think this is through seeing failure, of partnerships. If you have been part of a partnership in name only, and you see that it fails to be more than the sum of its parts because people are all arguing for their own end, their own agenda within that partnership, then you realise that you need a different approach to that. You need the people within that to approach it with a sense of what's the greater good here that we can all contribute to that gets enough of my agenda met, but is something bigger, is something more than the sum of its parts. And I've seen so many activities where that's not been the case, where they end up as less than the sum of their parts, particularly in the social sector, where organisations that might collaborate are also competitors for funds, and they have a difficulty, therefore, placed in their way by external forces in collaborating meaningfully. But I think that that's a real problem. And I think that, again, you're asking how does an individual change the way that they approach this? I don't know, other than saying for myself, it was about reflecting on those failures that I had been a part of and realizing that the approach just needed to be completely reversed, and that the only way that I could have an impact on future partnerships, future collaborative efforts that I was involved in would be that simply to approach it differently myself. And There is a, at least lip service to the idea across every field I work in, and I've worked in a lot of fields, at least lip service to the idea that collaboration is necessary.
Yes.
That in this interconnected world, things work differently now, and things don't change through the actions of one individual or one organisation ever, meaningfully. So I think that the possibility is there, but it does require a mindset shift. Mm. That it's not just about marriages of convenience, but it only really works if you genuinely understand what others are trying to achieve.
And again, I'm going to ask the question, how do you actually do that? Because you say the competing, three organizations technically competing for the same pot need to collaborate in order to achieve something. How do they actually do that in a meaningful way? Because what tends to happen, as you said there, is that there's lip service to it. There's, we're doing this. And so what's the difference that could enable that to work?
The difference is good leadership, I think. The difference is when there are people leading leading one organization's engagement in a project, in a collaborative project, who go in with the attitude that this is not just about us. Mm. Again, it doesn't answer the question of how does an individual leader change their mindset, but
yeah.
I think that that's the only thing that can make a difference, really. I think it's very difficult for people who have less power and authority within an organization to determine the nature of those relationships. You need people with a sufficient level of power to have the right attitude and to approach the collaboration in that manner.
Again, I'm hearing that cathedral building type mentality in there as well. So what constitutes good leadership? What do we need in terms of leaders these days?
Strategy. strategy, sensible, real strategy. The number of documents that I read that purport to be a strategy document that are nothing of the kind, they are merely a list of targets,
right,
is incredible. I'm constantly shocked by how bad organisations are at this, and that people can get to the top of organisations without being good at strategy, without having that sense of looking in, the job being to look into the future and to chart a sensible course through unknown, unmapped territory. I think that that's the fundamental job of leadership. And there's no magic to strategy. It is about thinking through the consequences, thinking through the possibilities, thinking sensibly about the environment in which you're operating, trying to do away with any magic thinking about if we do this, then this will happen, and we'll all be living in under rainbows.
Yes.
You know, it's about being realistic, ultimately.
Okay.
And not having... Again, I suppose this goes back to the thing I said earlier about the entrepreneur needing to veer between different extremes, because whilst it is often very useful to set unrealistic goals in order to encourage other people, if you are lying to yourself about the possibility of achieving those unrealistic goals, I don't think that you have much chance of getting there. I think you have to be completely rational and clear-headed about what are the challenges that you're going to face and how you're going to overcome them. That's what's missing in most of these strategies I'm complaining about. They don't say how.
Okay. So it's just, here's a target, we'll hit that.
Yeah. We'll work better. We'll be more effective. We'll pivot to digital.
Okay.
But without thinking about, well, what does that actually mean in practice? How is it that we're going to do these things? What do we need to stop doing, and what do we need to do more of? I think that's really important. Being open-eyed about how difficult it is to achieve anything.
Yes.
Actually.
Which is great when we're running a change project.
Well, it's very difficult to take control. One of my competitors, actually, as a social change consultant, but a very smart guy called Ben Metz, who used to run Ashoka UK, wrote something that I really like. He said that one might think that, I'm paraphrasing here, obviously, one might think that the people in positions of power want to maintain the status quo. But actually that's not true. People in positions of power attempt to control the way society is changing. And people who aren't in positions of power don't have any purchase on the process. So they are merely in the wake of this social change and having to respond. So I think that one of the things that is positive, to go back to the a positive end to this discussion maybe, and to the big question of societal change, is that often the decision to try to take control of the direction of social travel, of travel and of society, is one that we can take without having to ask other people, and one that I hope the young generation are realizing they can take without having to ask other people.
Which seems like the perfect place to close the conversation, as you say, on a positive note. James, thank you so much. It's been an absolute pleasure, as ever, to have this conversation. I look forward to the adventures ahead and many interesting projects. I think I get a feeling we should work together again on something at some point.
We definitely should,
Neil. Thank you so much. Thank you for listening to this 91 Untold Change Project podcast. I'm Neil Almond. If you've enjoyed it, please subscribe. You can also keep in touch with our adventures on social or at 91untold.com. Thank you for listening, and we look forward to the adventures ahead.